Top Chinese and French officials meet amid China's trade issues with the European Union. Chinese Premier Li Qiang and French Foreign Ministry or Minister Catherine Colonna held talks in Beijing as France seeks to soothe ties after an anti-subsidy probe was launched by the EU into Chinese-made electric vehicles. China described the investigation as protectionist. The development also comes ahead of a visit by the European Commission and Council Presidents Ursula von der Leyen and Charles Michel to Beijing for the first in-person summit with Chinese President Xi Jinping in 4 years. The start of the long-awaited truce in the Israel-Hamas war now underway. Qatar, which served as mediator in the talk, says the four-day pause in fighting began at 7 a.m. local time, while the first 13 hostages held by Hamas, all women and children, will be released Friday afternoon.
Our aim is for this deal to end with a lasting truce. Right now, of course, the confines of this deal are these 4 days that are subject to a second phase and following phases of expanding the pause through the formula of getting more hostages out and therefore getting more time for the pause. We are hoping that momentum will carry and that we would find this would open the door for further and more deep negotiations towards an end to this violence.
The four-day truce marks the most significant diplomatic breakthrough yet since the October 7 attack of Hamas on Israel, triggering a full-blown war. At least 50 Hamas hostages are set to be freed in exchange for the release of 150 Palestinians. The deal will also allow aid to pour into Gaza, including thousands of liters of fuel. The financial markets in Asia, they are mixed following the release of key economic data from the world's third biggest economy. Japan saw its core inflation rate rise slower than anticipated in October at 2.9%. That is slightly higher than the previous 2.8% recorded in September. Headline inflation also came in higher at 3.3%, accelerating from the 3% recorded from the previous month. The East Asian country's factory activity also remained in contraction in November. Let's take a look now at the major stock indices. Japan's Nikkei 225 climbing 0.5% after a national holiday there. Meanwhile, Hong Kong's Hang Seng Index plunged by nearly 2%. South Korea's Kospi Index is also down, shedding 0.7% in today's trade. Let's take a look now at futures in Europe. They are set for a muted open as the Thanksgiving holiday in the U.S. make investors cautious to place major bets. In the UK, Barclays will be in focus after Reuters reported a British bank is working on plans to save as much as $1.25 billion, which could involve cutting as many as 2,000 jobs. Stateside now, futures are also pointing to a flat open, with Wall Street set to close early. Climate change and world security high on the agenda during a summit between Canada and the European Union. Canadian Prime Minister Justin Trudeau welcomed European Council President Charles Michel and European Commission President Ursula von der Leyen for a two-day summit on Thursday. Officials said, aside from global security amid the wars in Ukraine and the Middle East, the clean energy development, artificial intelligence will also be discussed.
Canada's joining Horizon Europe, which is the greatest research and innovation mechanism in the world right now. We're also talking about a digital partnership that is going to make a huge difference, building on that as we work together to understand the impacts of AI, the impacts of disinformation and misinformation on the social media that people get to overwhelm by in so many ways that tend to exacerbate our challenges.
New Zealand's National Party has formally inked a deal to form the country's next three-party coalition government after negotiating for more than a month over ministerial roles and policies. The role of Deputy Prime Minister, a key sticking point in the discussions, will be split between the populist NZ First Party leader Winston Peters and Libertarian ACT Party leader David Seymour. The coalition also revealed a series of policy changes, including amending the Reserve Bank of New Zealand Act 2021 to remove the dual mandate on inflation and employment to focus on monetary policy to focus monetary policy only on price stability.
I said on election night that we would be a government that would deliver for every New Zealander, regardless of who we are, where we are, and whatever our life circumstances are. How we do that has been at the very core of our negotiations. The negotiation process has been diligent, it's been focused, and it's been purposeful.
The European Union has extended its generalized system of preference plus trade pact to the Philippines. U.S. or EU's envoy to Manila, Luc Veron, shared that news on social media, saying the deal has been extended until 2027. Now, the GSP Plus arrangement allows duty-free exports on over 6,000 Philippine products to the EU. Veron added, the EU and the Philippines are also jointly exploring the possibility of resuming free trade agreement negotiations.
In an ambush interview just this morning, Philippine President Marcos Jr. said the government is studying the return of the Philippines to the ICC. Bia Gutierrez filed this report.
Republic of the Philippines. President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. says the Philippine government is currently studying the country's possible return to the International Criminal Court. The statement comes as the president answered media questions on the mounting calls from lawmakers in the House of Representatives for the Philippine government to cooperate with the ICC's probe on his predecessor's war on drugs. In an interview here in Taguig Friday, Marcos Jr. says that while the House resolutions are not unusual, there are still questions on the ICC's jurisdiction over the Philippines that still needs to be resolved. The Philippines, under the Duterte administration, formally withdrew from the ICC in March 2019 after the body launched a preliminary examination of President Duterte's bloody war on drugs.
This is not unusual, but it's really a sense of the House resolution. And it's the sense that they are just expressing or manifesting the sense of the House that perhaps it's time to allow or to cooperate with the ICC investigations. But as I've always said, there are still some problems in terms of jurisdiction and sovereignty. Now, if you can solve those problems, then that would be something else. But medyo fundamental yung mga question na ganun eh. Because if you're talking about the sovereign jurisdiction of the ICC, especially since we have withdrawn from the Rome Statutes a few years back, that brings into question whether or not this is actually possible. There is also a question, should we return under the fold of the ICC? So that's again under study. So we'll just keep looking at it and see what our options are.
In the same interview, the president reiterated his earlier stand that a foreign body should not dictate on the government on who should be investigated, who should be arrested, or who should be jailed, as he noted that the Philippines has its own functioning justice system. Marcos, in 2022, earlier said that the ICC's ongoing probe into the bloody drug war is a threat to the country's sovereignty, as he maintained that the ICC has no jurisdiction over the Philippines and that any judgment from the court regarding the case would not be legitimate.
I have to congratulate.
President Marcos Jr. starts to reap the fruits of his working visit to the U.S. with the inauguration of the Healthway Cancer Care Hospital on Friday. The HCCH, the first cancer facility in the country, was officially unveiled along South Union Drive in Taguig City. In his speech, Marcos said the opening of the hospital will improve access to quality cancer care in the country. The HCCH is one of the deals Marcos witnessed on the sidelines of the recently concluded APEC Summit in San Francisco. It's a partnership between Ayala Corp Health, the Philippine Health Department, and U.S.-based Varian Medical Systems.
With the help of HCCH, we can revolutionize the cancer care service industry in the Philippines through modern, state-of-the-art equipment coupled with leading medical professionals and oncologists. It will certainly positively reflect on the country's growing potential as a leading healthcare destination in Asia.